been through a lot of changes. And the biggest change, in fact, I moved away from Virginia. I now live in Pennsylvania. So the lighting in here is a lot better. Lighting in my new place is a lot better. The acoustics are a little bit, you know, echoey, and there's traffic like right outside my window because I live along a rather busy road. Never mind the fact that it's after 11 p.m. where I'm at right now. But, there's traffic on this road like almost, like maybe all but 5 hours of every day, because like things slow down after midnight, but around 5 in the morning everybody's doing the commute. They're going to work or doing whatever, going to school, because the college campus is like right like within 5 to 10 minutes walk from my place. So the center of town is about a 10-minute walk from here too. So I'm like right in the middle of it. And the road outside is like one of the main roads in town. I live in Lancaster. So it's not a really big town, but it's really condensed. The reason it doesn't feel really big is because I live right in the middle of everything. And I don't have to go very far to reach the things that I need. So I don't really need to travel, you know, all over town to find anything. So that's what's been going on with me. And I'm finally able to do one of these videos proper. So, excuse me if the floor creaks a little bit. I'm on the second floor. You'll hear traffic outside passing by every once in a while. Like right there. It sounds a little bit like wind, but, you know, not enough. You might hear the refrigerator pop on. But anyway, I am not used to doing videos like these because the camera is tipped at a very awkward angle. As you can see, there is what appears to be a leather jacket down here. Yes, I have gloves on, just because. You can see at the top edge of the video one of my buttons, and I'll be taking you on a tour of my buttons. I have a lot of them, but this is my jacket. I've had this jacket since 2001, I think. So it's been almost, it's been about 14 years that I've had this jacket. And you can kind of tell if you wear it, because there are no pockets in there anymore. It's just a bunch of, just a couple of holes at the side that pass for pockets. There's no lining on the inside. But you can still fit things in it. The main reason that I brought this out was so... The main reason I brought this out was to show you all my buttons. This jacket is kind of my trademark. People tend to recognize me because of this jacket. And I wear it to all my conventions. And I wear it around town. Pretty much anywhere I go where the weather requires a jacket, this is what I wear. And people are often remarking about how they like my buttons. And a lot of people ask where I get them. And I tell them I get them at all the conventions I go to. So basically, where some people have buttons of all the bands that they have seen at live shows, I have buttons that mark the conventions I've been to. And they also mark how many conventions I've been to, and I've been to a lot. As a matter of fact, at the beginning of November, the first weekend of November was my 65th convention overall. I started going to conventions in 2004. So it roughly comes out to about, you know, an average of 6 conventions a year. So let's take a little tour of my jacket here, or my buttons. It did say there were a lot of them. Start down here. Now this pink one right here, I got from a Lolita. Her name is Rin Rin Doll. This was something that, this was one of the buttons that she was selling. She does a lot of makeup work. She does a lot of fashion consulting. She does a lot of Lolita tea parties and gatherings. She travels a lot. I think she lives in Korea or something. I don't know. I don't remember where she lives exactly, but she was at NecoCon, which was the last convention I was at. And this was the button that I decided that I was going to take. And let's move up here. If you have ever played Five Nights at Freddy's, you know these characters. This character right here, that's Mr. Marionette. He's not a pleasant character. And this is Golden Freddy, or Freddy Fazbear. the star of that horrific game. And this right here, this is Foxy. I apologize for the camera jerking around like that. The little rod that is attached to the tripod that holds it in place. This is a very old tripod. I need to replace it. So, moving up a little further, we have some anime buttons. Pardon the focus. Let's see if the focus will clear itself up. Apparently, no. Now over here, it says objection. That's from Phoenix Wright, Ace Attorney. It's apparently a Nintendo DS game series. I don't own anything Nintendo. I'm an Xbox person. So I do know a lot of Nintendorks out there. This is an artist button right here. This is Madoka Kaname. And she is from a show called Maho Shoujo Madoka Magica. This looks like a cutesy anime at first, but by the end of episode 3, and I say episode 3 specifically because it is episode 3 that pretty much rips your heart out. It's pretty much by design. Over here, this is Sayaka Miki, if I'm not mistaken. Forgive me if I forget these names. I'm not very good with names. But this is Sayaka. Over here next to her is Companion Cube. If you know the game Portal, you know what these things are. And there's not much explanation needed for that. This right here, this is Mommy. Spelled M-A-M-I, Mommy. I'm not gonna spoil anything about the show, but she is the main reason that that show pretty much rips your heart out and shows it to you before it is eaten alive. Next to her is what some people consider a villain. He's not the villain, he's the anti-hero. He's the anti-hero. His name is Kyubei. Short for incubator. There's a lot to explain about that show and its plot. You can hear that in the background. That's my heater vent. So, anyway, Kyubei looks all cute and everything, but as the show goes on, you realize there's really nothing cute about this little guy, thing, whatever. Because Kyubei has no emotion. He's immortal. It is immortal. I keep saying he. Kyubei is genderless. Not male or female or anything. He just is. It just is. I keep forgetting to do that. So, and this is another character. I keep forgetting her name, but she's also a big part of it. You can see right here, that's a meme button. Meme. I don't remember what they actually called this one. But, yeah. It's emoji face, I guess. And I cannot believe that I'm drawing a blank on her name, because she is like, aside from Madoka, she is like the other main character. She is like actually the one character that is consistent throughout the entire series, and I can't remember her name. Somebody slapped me upside the head. That is bad. Bad nerd. That's me. Over here, this is one of the characters I cosplayed for a couple of years. This is Excalibur. He is from Soul Eater. And if you've ever seen Soul Eater, you know what he's all about. If you've never seen Soul Eater, he only appears in a few episodes, but he makes a rather lasting impact, let's put it that way, a rather lasting impression on everyone, for better or worse. Right here, we have a Pokeball. This is a, you know, this is that thing that you see in Pokemon, these things that you see the characters throwing around to try and catch them all. Right here, Star Fox Coffee. Of course, you know, it's a play on Starbucks. It's a video game reference, very old. I think it's a Nintendo 64 game. I used to play it a lot. I just can't, you know, readily remember exactly which Nintendo system this was for, but I'm pretty sure it was a 64. I used to get so frustrated with this game. I'd never reached the end boss. I never reached the end boss to this game, and, that sucked. So I never really got the full experience of Star Fox. This here, I know, is a reference to Zelda. You know, The Legend of Zelda. I don't know what exactly. I don't remember the name. I should, but I don't. But someone made a meme out of it. They gave it an awesome face. So, you know, no, this is not the face on the moon. This Majora's moon, is that what it is? Majora's mask is what I'm thinking of. Ah, God. I'm doing so bad. I'm losing nerd points right and left right now. This right here is nothing specific. One of my conventions. One of my conventions were handing these out. It was just, you know, it's just, you know, a piece of art that got turned into a button. This right here, pretty self-explanatory. Oh my God, what the fuck? I tend to say that a lot. This is actually part of the name of one of the presentations that I give at every convention. It's basically a highlight of really bad Japanese television. Anyway, moving on. Over here, this is, oh my God, this is from Soul Eater as well. No one knows it's supposed to be male, but his mom dresses him as a female. Very scared, very timid character. And I'm not even going to try to remember names because I'm so bad at it right now. I should know it because I was thinking about cosplaying this character. I'm sure it'll come to me when I'm done doing this video, and then I'll feel really dumb. This right here was one of the first buttons I picked up. This was from Takotokan 3 back in 2005, which was the second convention I went to. This is Hino. Hino is kind of like the Tom Jones or the Dean Martin of Germany. He's a lounge act. He sings like classic songs. And there's a reason that he wears sunglasses all the time. There was a video of Hino. Now, Hino, he's an old timer. You know, he's been doing this for a long time. Now, the reason he wears sunglasses all the time is because he does not blink. And when he looks at the camera, he stares at the camera wide-eyed. He opens his eyes all the way. Very bug-eyed expression, and it's really creepy. So they found it best to make him wear sunglasses. And that's the story behind Hino. This green thing right here. It's a Vocaloid button. One of the songs they do is called Matryoshka. And if you don't know what Matryoshka is, it's basically it's a type of doll from Russia. And since Vocaloid songs tend to be in Japanese, I don't know what the song is actually about. But they somehow chose the name of a Russian doll. This is the Miku version of the Miku Matryoshka. Over here, this is one of my punk buttons. This is really old and weathered. As you can tell, these are the Black Flag bars. That's the Black Flag logo. Black Flag is, of course, Henry Rollins' old band. Let's see if I can zoom in anymore. There we go. Try to zoom in, and the focus goes wonky. That's the trademark of one of the old punk bands that I still listen to. And next to that, I'm not exactly sure what this button represents. It says ogre, and maybe that's the Japanese character for the word ogre, but I don't know why. It came in a grab bag that, sometimes I will pick up a $20 grab bag in the dealer's room on any given Sunday of, the convention that I'm at. But, lately, in recent years, I haven't been able to afford to do that much. So I've had to kind of, keep away from the dealer's room. That's a derpy button. It's a derpy button. This, of course, is a reference to My Little Pony. And next to that, we have it's a Brohoof button. Of course, that's Rainbow Dash. Brohoofing another pony. Of course, there's an artist rendition of Derpy. I pick up artist buttons as well as, actual, licensed buttons. Actually, most of the buttons that you've seen already are artist renditions. Next to that is Deadpool. Deadpool's face. I can't reach up that far from where I'm sitting. And next to that is We'll wait for that truck to go by. That button there is seen in Dead Rising. Well, it's not this button, it's the jacket. The name on the jacket of the main character of Dead Rising 2, actually. That's the name of his racing team, I think, his motorcycle racing team. That name is on his jacket. So I recognize that. And not that I ever got halfway through Dead Rising 2. I could never get very far with those Dead Rising games. I'm just not very good at those zombie games. It's a shooter and it's a survival game, but again, I'm just not very good at them. A little jerky. We can't help that. I'm sorry. I apologize. You can see at the top there, it's Neon Cat. That cat with a kitty head and a Pop-Tart for a body, and he's flying with rainbows shooting out of his butt. The button next to that says, "Your online journal blows." This was back when live journal was a thing. It still kind of is a thing, just not as much as it used to be. But it's one of the first buttons I got. I think I got it at the same convention as I got the Hino button. And the one below that you can see it says Circle Jerks. It's another old punk band that I still listen to from time to time. That button is very weathered, very beaten up. The one to the left of that is an artist rendition, I believe, I want to say Kenshin. I can't be sure. I really don't remember. Below that, Luffy D. Pirate from One Piece. One Piece is like a major, major big deal. It's still going. The source manga is still being written. This series has been going on forever. So, there's no way that I could possibly catch up to what's going on now or before. I don't know what number episode they are on you know, Toonami right now. I have to imagine it's pretty high up there. But the episodes are still coming. Next to that, it's a Fear button. Another punk band. Surprise, surprise. And they're a punk band from 1981. They only had really one good album. They've released a few, but Fear, the album, was probably their best one. This one right here, the blue one, another kind of random anime drawing. That button is pretty weathered too. It's showing its age. And over here, sorry, it says glomp this. Now, for those of you who don't know what a glomp is, that's basically when someone comes running at you, and as soon as they get near you, they jump, and they basically a flying tackle hug. And the goal is to knock their target down and them to land on top of you and a hug, and it's usually not appreciated. The recipient of these glops, they tend to not know that it's happening until it happens. So there was a lot of discussion about these things, and you know, they were kind of outlawed. So now you're supposed to get the person's permission before you glop them. It's only fair. This here is a weathered button of an artist rendition of Fluttershy next to another derpy button. And it's going to be fairly obvious that I'm into My Little Pony. If it hasn't been, you know, made rather apparent already. Over here is the cutie mark for Nightmare Moon, I believe. Or Luna. It's Nightmare Moon or Luna. I can't remember. Maybe they're both the same. I don't remember. I'm a bad My Little Pony fan too. It's not good that I cannot recall all this stuff. But I'm going to say this is Princess Luna's mark. Next to Derpy's mark. Derpy's mark being the bubbles. Over here we have other cutie marks. The apples, of course, represent Applejack. To the left of that is Rainbow Dash. And then there's Rarity, symbolized by the diamonds. And then the balloons represent Pinkie Pie, because she's into partying all the time. I think her and Andrew WK would get along really good. And there's Fluttershy's cutie mark, butterflies. And down here is Twilight Sparkle. I can reach them again. Twilight Sparkle. I'm going to love and tolerate the crap out of you. It's a pretty valuable piece of advice. And then there's an artist rendition of Rainbow Dash and an artist rendition of Pinkie Pie. Moisture has not gotten to these two yet. Well, it kinda has. You can see the outside circle around Rainbow Dash. I'm really not very good about taking care of my buttons, as you can tell. There's Twilight Sparkle's mark, that red star in the purple. Right there, well, I'll explain that in a minute, but there's Daring Do. This is Rainbow Dash's hero. Daring Do. The Indiana Jones of the Pony Realm. Over here, we have a very old button. Very, very old. This button predates every other button on this jacket. I am a fan of Taco Bell. Always have been. Remember the little chihuahua? Yo quiero Taco Bell. That's where it comes from. I think I was working at Taco Bell before I moved to Virginia, and I got one of these buttons. I think we were supposed to wear these buttons around on our uniforms, but I kept mine. I still have one of the little dogs that they were selling, they said different things. One of them says, I think I need a bigger box. And the one I have just says, Yo quiero Taco Bell. Well, it used to say it. I think whatever battery might be in there has long since died. But I still have the dog. This right here is Scootaloo. Artist rendition of Scootaloo. Next to Princess Celestia's mark. And over here we have... that is Sweetie Belle. Apple Bloom jumped ship a long time ago, and I don't know where it happened. I don't know when or why it happened, but I only have two of the three Cutie Mark Crusaders, and those were artist buttons, so they were unique. And I don't know, I don't think I'm ever gonna find them again. So I'm gonna have to find some kind of Apple Bloom button to replace the one that was lost. And you know, we're coming to the end of our little tour. Actually, this is the end of the button tour. Right here. This is a button I got last year. Teco. Team Teco. This is what we call ourselves. This is what we've been... This is what the attendees of Tekoshokan have long since called themselves. We have long been known as Team Teco. It's kind of a bonding thing. This is in a convention that a lot of people are extremely loyal to. Because it's an awesome convention out in Pittsburgh. It sounds like one of the kids in the next apartment is acting up. So, I'm gonna end this real soon. Because I'm afraid that kid is going to make a lot of noise. And you don't want to hear kids screaming in the background. So, anyway... Kennywood is an amusement park near Pittsburgh. And this is what they do every year. They have a Kennywood Day. Like, a month or two after every year's Teco. And this is because people, you know, they get post-con depression and stuff. And people want to go back and gather with the people that they met at Teco, but, you know, don't get to see all the time. And, of course, you get to spend a day at an amusement park, roller coasters and all that stuff. So that's fun. So, there you have it. This is the jacket that I wear everywhere. And this is what I've been known for. Oh, there's a couple of buttons up there. The one on the left lapel, you can't really see it, but it's like, I think it's a maple leaf. Some kind of marine uniform decoration that I picked up at a surplus store. And the one on the right is written in Russian. And I don't know, I don't remember what that represents. But I pick up shiny things that you can stick to your jacket, and I put them on my jacket because I like the way it sounds. When you walk around, you hear the jingle and the chatter. these buttons. And I'm always looking for more buttons. So if you want to send me anything at all, send me more buttons. Because all these buttons are special. All the buttons I get are special. And I know where I got them from. I know what they represent. And I try and do what I can to preserve them. I can't do it as well as I'd like, because weather happens, and I sometimes get caught in it. And sometimes weather does bad things to buttons. So if you want to send me anything, send me more buttons. And thus ends the tour of my jacket. That's the Russian thing right there. See if I can turn it out a little bit. This is that thing. I don't know what it says and I don't know what it's for. I think I got it at another military surplus place. And then over here there's the, you know, this has caused a few people to ask me if I served in the Marines, and I have to explain to them that, no, this is just something I picked up at a military surplus place. They sell pins, they sell buttons, they sell decorations. So, anyway, this is the brand name of the jacket. And, yeah. Thanks for sticking with me on this little tour. I hope the outside noises weren't too distracting. And I hope that, you enjoyed this little tour. My jacket. Oh, many buttons. And as soon as I can figure out a quieter place to do these videos, I'll make more. But for now, this is Deuce Loosely. And I will be talking to you all later.